In order to understand blockchain technology like a pro, knowing its ins and outs, we need to delve into the heart of what blockchain looks like from a technical perspective. This is where distributed systems come in. Blockchains are a specific type of distributed system, and everything we know to the present about distributed systems will allow us to properly understand blockchain. So, what is a distributed system? The definition of a distributed system changes depending on who you ask, but the general consensus, no pun intended, is that distributed systems contain two particular categories of components. The first category is referred to as nodes. Nodes are meant to represent separate machines or processes. This separation manifests in the real world as physical distance, such as in Bitcoin, or just a separation of components, similar to the CPU cores in your laptop. The second category is referred to as message passing. These are represented as arrows or edges, as we like to call them in the context of graph theory. Regardless of their name, their purpose is to demonstrate that information can move between machines. It isn't guaranteed that all machines are directly or even indirectly connected. However, that doesn't stop them from working together. The biggest question on your mind, though, might be, why do distributed systems matter? What's wrong with a single system? Well, the problem of machines in the real world is that they can be faulty, crash, lose memory, or even be corrupted. In this event, we're able to protect information and services by creating backups. In other words, putting many machines together to accomplish a goal instead of having just a single machine. This brings us to the main advantage of a more reliable system. Even if one machine shuts down or misbehaves, it's not the end of the world. We can create protocols withstanding failure, giving us the power to be safe in the event of a crash. Let's discuss the properties of a distributed system, keeping in mind the two main components to understand exactly what we're working with. One of the most obvious components of a distributed system is concurrency. Components in the system process information concurrently, as opposed to a single process which operates one step at a time. Second, there is no global clock. While all nodes can attempt to stay synchronized, there is no single clock or computer to access for the current time. Each node is responsible for maintaining its own time. A fun fact, time and its effect on the operation of a distributed system constantly comes up in heated debates across the academic world. Third, as mentioned before, there's potential for failure of any individual component, whether this may be a dropped message or a failed processor. In these events, protocols protect the system against individual failure, ensuring that the job gets done no matter what. All these properties of distributed systems come straight from understanding the role of nodes and edges in this system. In the next section, we're going to be looking at how we distinguish a working distributed system from a faulty one. This graph shows a classic example problem from distributed systems. Consider an arrangement of an odd number of nodes as such. Imagine that each node randomly starts off with one of two values, 0 or 1. This is known as a binary consensus problem, as there are only two possible inputs for each node and only two possible outputs for the entire network. The goal of this system is to, through messages and computation, return the majority value among all nodes. From looking at this graph, you can easily tell that the answer must be 0, given that there are 5 zeros and only 4 ones. Before we start considering the exact process by which this system can reach the answer, let's first ask ourselves, what exactly are we looking for in this system? What properties do we want to uphold? What constitutes a correct answer? We're about to answer those questions right now. Leslie Lamport, distributed systems researcher and superhero, designed a scheme by which we can formally prove the correctness of a distributed system. It's a fundamentally simple scheme, as it's a scheme you can apply to any kind of engineering. Lamport says that a system is correct if two things are true, that it doesn't do bad things, and that it eventually does good things. The formal terms of these are safety and liveness, respectively. Safety properties refer to things that will not happen, and liveness refers to things that eventually happen. To understand what this means, let's use the previous example. Which types of results do we want, and which do we not want? I would say it's reasonably clear to see what we don't want. If our goal is for a majority value to be returned, then we would never want a program to return a value that's not the majority value. That's a safety property. A liveness property is that the majority value will eventually be returned. You'll notice that the safety and liveness properties are difficult to fulfill simultaneously, as getting closer to one means getting further from the other. You'll also notice why we can't just have safety or just liveness. Take real life as an example. Living your life as safely as possible would be staying inside all day and never talking to anyone. Nothing can go wrong, true, but nothing will ever happen either. On the other hand, you could also be incredibly spontaneous to live the most lively life imaginable. However, without sufficient regulation of your actions, you'll likely get into serious trouble. You need some of both, but not too much, to define a sense of what your program can and should do. We spent quite a bit of time understanding safety and liveness, but how do we apply these ideas of desirable and undesirable guidelines to distributed system? How can we prove that our system achieves its goal? Well, for any distributed system to be correct, we know that it must come to some form of consensus on the correct answer. That's the whole point of a distributed system. Given some input, the nodes need to agree on the output. The names given to these consensus-achieving procedures are known as consensus algorithms. We can put consensus algorithms in the context of safety and liveness by establishing what must happen and what cannot happen in order for a system to come to consensus. Lucky for us, computer scientists much smarter than us have already done that, recognizing that there are three requirements of any correct consensus algorithm, which are validity, agreement, and termination. Validity means that any value decided upon by the network must be proposed by one of its processes. In other words, the consensus algorithm cannot arbitrarily agree on some result. It cannot be hard-coded to always return the value zero. Sure, all nodes will agree that the value is zero and be in agreement, but is that really a valid answer? If every node started off with one and we're looking for a majority value, zero is meaningless. Agreement means that all non-faulty processes must agree on the same value. It's pointless to bother with results of faulty processes, since those can always be wrong. So what matters is the agreement of the remainder. Of the working nodes, we never want to end up in a situation where one says zero and one says one. If there are inconsistencies in a result, then which one is true? Which one is correct? In order for the result to be meaningful, all functioning processes must agree on it. The last requirement is termination. Termination means that all non-faulty nodes will eventually decide on some value. In other words, the system must eventually return some value. It cannot forever hang in limbo. As you can tell, both validity and agreement are safety properties. They specify things that can never happen in a system coming to consensus. By having validity and agreement, we ensure that honest nodes will never decide on trivial, random, or different values. Termination, on the other hand, is a liveness property, as it specifies what must happen for a system to be considered correct. Without the guarantee of termination, we have no guarantee that consensus will ever be reached. By understanding these three essentials of a consensus algorithm, you now understand what is needed for any distributed system to come to consensus. In addition, identifying the goals of a consensus algorithm is critical to understanding different approaches. Before we get into examples of consensus algorithms, however, we need to understand more of the caveats of distributed systems and the trade-offs that any system must make.